be addressing all of you today. First of all, I must thank the university for conferring this honorary degree on me, and I hope that I will be able to do enough for education in Burma to deserve such an honor. There's much that we have to do, and there's much support and help that we need from our singers. The subject on which I have been asked to speak today is development and democracy in Asia. This is, of course, a vast subject and would require several volumes if one were to treat it thoroughly. But I would like to talk mainly about the direction in which I would like my country as a nation of Asia to go in the matter of developing democracy. Democracy is a very broad word. It's a very broad subject. And it can be subjected to many different interpretations. But basic to our ideas of democracy are the ideas of freedom, justice, and security. I've often said that democracy has to strike a healthy balance between freedom and security, because all human beings want freedom, and at the same time, they want security. They do not want to sacrifice one for the other. Many authoritarian regimes emphasize security and deprive the people of their freedom. But on the other hand, unlimited freedom, which will threaten the security of the citizens, is not what we would wish for. So a healthy balance between freedom and security, upheld by the rule of law, is what we would aim towards. Within such a context, I believe that our country can develop and become the kind of nation that we have always hoped that it would be. Many years ago, that is to say, in 1948, we achieved independence from the British colonial government. Before that, our freedom fighters, the fighters for independence in Burma, always spoke of their desire to be able to shape the destiny of their nation. They did not want the destiny of the nation to be shaped by others, by foreign powers. They wanted to be the ones to decide what shape their nation should take. And it was with this call for our right to shape the destiny of our nation that we became independent. But not too long after, that is to say, less than two decades after we achieved independence, Burma fell under military rule. And during that time, the people of our country did not have an opportunity to take part in the shaping of the destiny of their nation, because that was taken over entirely by the rulers. So, for us, democracy means, at this moment, the right to shape the destiny of our nation as the fathers of our independence wanted us to be able to do. And I think this would be true of all the nations of Asia who hope to achieve democracy. Democracy in Asia is shaped to a certain extent by our customs, by traditions, by our history. I read a book many years ago before the 1988 uprising for democracy in Burma, where it was pointed out that among the nations of Asia, Burma would have the greatest difficulty in achieving democracy because of our social values. I was amazed at how perceptive the writer was. He pointed out some of the drawbacks in our social values that would militate against the establishment of democracy. Other countries were discussed, including Korea, and the point is made that although he did not put it specifically, it is implied that all these other nations would probably achieve democracy before Burma did. And this is true. This has turned out to be true. We have not yet achieved democracy. We are just beginning to start out on the road. This is a point that I have to keep repeating, that Burma is still trying to achieve democracy. We're preparing the ground, but we have not yet planted the seeds of democracy firmly in our soil. And as we work towards it, we obviously look to the other nations of Asia to find out what we can learn from them. The one advantage of it behind everybody else is that we can learn from their mistakes as well as their successes. What I find in traveling abroad is that there has been tremendous material development the world over. When I went to Europe last year, I first went to Thailand for a few days and then I went to Europe last June. It was the first time in over 25 years that I have traveled to developed countries. I found that those countries were rich. nearer you than we had ever been. It was a little bit of a surprise to me because, of course, I had heard on the radio about the economic downturn, the problems that were supposed to be plaguing the affluent world. And yet, in spite of that, it was the Europe that I saw last year was noticeably wealthier than the Europe that I saw back in the early 1980s. This was the same for the United States of America. Obviously, it was the same for China. Korea, I had never been before, so this is my first visit to Korea, but I have no doubt that it is far wealthier now than it was in the early 1980s. In spite of these material improvements, I did not feel downhearted for my country. I understand that we are behind everybody else in both democratic and economic development. But is that not in any way worrying? Because I feel that this gives us an opportunity to follow the kind of path that will lead to the kind of nation that we would like to build. And the kind of nation that I would like to see my country turn out to be is one which emphasizes some of the human values which it seems to me have been lost along the way to economic development. I know that it is not fashionable these days to talk about such values as compassion and kindness and harmony, but these are absolutely necessary for our world today. There is too much conflict and too much violence in our world, and we need to do something about it. Especially the young people need to do something about it, because it is their future. It is the world that they are going to be living in. The older people, we shall be leaving it soon with all its chaos to the young to cope with. So it is up to the young to make sure that development, whether politically, economically, or socially, would lead towards greater harmony rather than towards greater strife. I am not aware that technological developments have in any way lessened the possibility of conflict in our world. It's not technology that is going to decide what kind of world we are going to build. It is human nature. It is our human will which will decide what kind of world we are able to build. So when you talk of democracy in Asia, I would like to talk about democracy with a more human face, with a kinder face, with a more responsible face. A democracy that is really meant to nurture people, not to help us get ahead in the roads to material development. Too many people link democracy with economic development. There are those who say either that economic development is necessary for democracy or that democracy is necessary for economic development. But there is less said about how necessary democracy may be for human development, that is to say, for nurturing the better qualities in human nature. I do believe that we are capable of developing the better qualities in ourselves. Otherwise, we would not be here today. We would still be living in caves and clubbing each other to death. So we have improved. We have been able to become better human beings. But there has to be a sustained effort to keep improving our human situation. And democracy should be a means rather than an end. I do agree with those who say that democracy is not a perfect system, but it is the best that human beings have been able to develop so far. Best for what is the question that we need to ask. Best for what? Best, in my opinion, it should be the best for building up a society that appeals to the best in human nature. Best should mean simply that. What appeals to the best in you? What appeals to the best in all of us? And that means linking responsibility with rights. Too often in a country like Burma, where we have the people have been deprived of their rights for long decades, people think of democracy solely in terms of rights, what they expect to get from a democratic system, and very little about what they should give. And this is something that I have to keep reminding our people, that democracy entails responsibility as well as rights, and that if we wish to enjoy our democratic rights, we have to be prepared to carry out our democratic responsibilities. And democratic responsibilities, taking the simple definition of democracy, as rule of the people. Democratic responsibility means responsible rule by people. So each person must not only be involved in the responsible rule of the country, he or she must take responsibility for ruling herself or himself. In the end, unless we are all able to rule our own personal natures, we will not be able to contribute very much towards justice and balance in this world. So when I think of democracy in Asia, I think of the kind of democracy I would like to see in my own country. And I have been greatly heartened by the reaction of our young people. Last year, when we were campaigning for the by-elections in Burma, the greatest support for our party came from the young people. And their enthusiasm, their aspirations, their dedication to contributing towards what we were trying to do was truly encouraging. Some of them did not quite know how to help us. They wanted to help. They wanted to help us to build the kind of nation that would be a true sanctuary for all of us, a nation that could be a true home. A home is a place where you feel safe, where you feel happy, where you feel confident that you belong. And this is the kind of home we want for all the peoples of Burma. We are a country of many ethnic nationalities. Whenever I speak of my country, I point out the fact that we are a union of many ethnic nationalities. But we are not yet a true union. Neither are we a democratic union as well. And this is what we have to try to achieve. And we would like to learn from our neighbors in Asia, from other Asian democracies, how to achieve national harmony. It is for this reason I'm particularly pleased to be in Korea and to learn from the Korean people, because they have been through the same kind of struggles that we have. They have had to struggle against military dictatorship and work to re-establish democratic government and also to achieve economic success. At the same time, the Koreans, more than perhaps many other peoples in the world, understand what inner conflict means, what a divided people means, what it entails, what hardships, what heartbreaks, personally as well as nationally. And we are still a people divided, because not all the ethnic nationalities of Burma have been able to come to an agreement. I always accept that the Burmese ethnic group, as the largest in the country, has the greatest responsibility. The greater your strength, whether numerically or materially, the greater your responsibility. And we have to work harder than any other ethnic nationality group to make sure that our country becomes a kind of democratic union which we have all longed for and which we must build up in order to repay the fathers of our independence for what they did to make our country a free nation in this world today. Democracy is a learning process. In fact, life is a learning process. And I hope that this is something of which our young people are aware, that learning never comes to an end. Once you think that you have learned enough, then I think it's trouble. You must always remember that there will never be a time when there is nothing left for you to learn. In this way, I feel that my country has much to learn, but also that other countries have much to learn from us. We may be poor now, we may be economically deprived. At the Special Olympics, I mentioned the fact that in some ways we can say that our country has suffered from social and political disabilities for the last 5 decades, because the first military regime was established in 1962. So 5 decades of social and political disablement is a large program, a problem for us to cope with. Yet in spite of us, I think you will have much to learn. If you come to Burma and you study the situation, you will be able to see the drawbacks that we have suffered from over the years. And at the same time, perhaps you will be able to see some of the values that you have lost along the road to development. There are some values which I would not like our people to lose. I would like to preserve some of our values, but these cannot be done artificially. These can be done only with the willing participation of the people. They themselves must believe that certain values need to be preserved, and they themselves must want to preserve these values. In this way, I would like to take my country forward to a kind of democracy which will lead to a kinder human society. I have said quite often that my experiences over the last two decades have convinced me that the most valuable quality human beings could possess is kindness. Kindness which costs nothing, but which people are so reluctant to give. I do not know why. Kindness costs none of us anything, and yet it is the greatest gift that you can give to another human being. Kindness is the ability to recognize others' needs and to do whatever you can to fulfill that need, not because you expect anything in return, but because it is your joy to give. So, if I have to put in a nutshell what kind of democracy I would like to see for my country, I would like to say I want to see a giving kind of democracy. The kind of democracy where people put emphasis on how much they can give and on the joy of giving rather than how much they can get and on the joy of receiving. And I hope that this is the kind of democracy that our Asian nations will aspire toward. I've noticed with pleasure and with genuine gratitude that some of the richer countries are beginning to adopt more and more humanitarian values. They are beginning to realize that material wealth is not all, that the true wealth lies only in human nature. And unless we can build a better, richer human nature among us, all the material development in the world is not going to get us greater happiness. I think this is the time limit I've been given. I'm very punctual. I have great respect for time because I believe that respecting time means respecting other people's time. So I would like to thank all of you for giving me this opportunity to speak to you. And also I would like to say that while I'm talking about the higher values of human nature, I also have a very practical political side to me. And one of the aims of my country, which is trying to establish democracy in Burma, is to make amendments to the constitution that will help us to win the elections in 2015. And I hope you will all help. Thank you very much.